Section 2 basketball playoffs in full force. Helping me break them down here at 1045theteam.com is a guy who lives for this, maybe even more than I do. It's Steve D'Agostino, who's a great player in Section 2 lore in his own right, and now trains a number of the top players in Section 2. Steve, how are you? Thanks for being with us.
Thanks for having me. It's a great time of year, you know.
Absolutely. Last night, what everyone's talking about, Joel Winkowski of Lake George needed 21 to surpass Jimmer Fredette as the all-time Section 2 leading scorer. He gets 34. Steve, man, how impressive is that? 2,400 points to be in the same conversation as Jimmer and now pass him. How impressive is that?
It's unbelievable, to be honest with you. I mean, you sit there and you really start to break down how many points that is just on a nightly basis to be able to score, you know, 20, 30, 40 points as he's gone from a freshman to a senior. It's crazy. And the one thing you need, and we tell all our players that if you want to really accomplish anything, not only in basketball and life, but you need consistency. And he's been a consistent scorer, you know, his whole career.
Steve, it's always a tough argument. There are plenty of people out there who, well, they'll acknowledge this is impressive. They don't want to acknowledge how impressive it is. They want to discount it a little bit, saying that he plays at Class C or saying that he doesn't play a Class AA schedule. They want to compare him to other players at bigger schools. That's not necessarily fair, is it?
You know, it doesn't matter. I'm a big fan of small school basketball, so the Class C thing doesn't matter. Yeah, Adirondack League, I think, has four of the top scorers in the section. So, you know, I don't know how much defense they're playing, but at the end of the day, like I said before, shooting and scoring is one thing that you have to do it. It's not like, hey, I'm a great ball handler, look at me, do my drills. You need to actually put the ball in the basket to be a scorer, and he's done that. Obviously, it is the best that anybody's ever done it in Section 2 in his career.
Class AA last night, no real surprises. A minor upset as the fifth seed of LaSalle tops fourth seeded Shaker. Green Tech rolls, and it's chalked the rest of the way. Shen gets the bye in the Class AA playoffs. I know you're big with Shen. I played at Shen. You do a lot of work with them. I think Schenectady is going to give them a pretty good game in round two. What do you think?
Yeah, it's funny. Those Hudson Valley games, ever since, you know, I used to go see them when I was a younger player, even in middle school and stuff. And it's always something about playing at Hudson Valley where there's four games in one day and the momentum's building throughout the day. I think every game's tough. And the one thing that, you know, all these teams have to realize in a one-and-done situation is you have an off night, and that could be it. That being said, I think Shen is the best team in Class AA. I would really like to see Shen versus Green Tech. I think it would be a great matchup. And, you know, I'm hoping that both of those teams take care of business the whole way through.
Gilderland wins last night. No real issues for them against Bishop McGinn. That's where you played. You certainly are well invested with the Dutchman as well. Everyone knows about Andrew Playtech and what a great scorer he is. But for me, the wild card for them is Mark Sitcho, the big man. If he had a 20-point game last night. If he has a big game on any given night with him complementing Playtech's outside game, I think Gilderland becomes very tough to beat.
Absolutely. And the biggest thing with Sitcho is getting touches. I mean, between Playtech and Simeone, their other guard on the wing, they have a lot of firepower scoring, and their point guard, Mike Wine, can get to the basket too. So, you know, the more that those guards can get Sitcho's touches, the easier it'll be for them on the perimeter to get shots. So they absolutely had that last night. I think when they beat Troy, Sitcho had like 23, 24 points. So I think moving forward, especially as you get deeper into the season here, you don't rely on jump shots so much. They're going to be feeding him the ball in the post and opening things up from the outside as well.
Class A, we saw limited action yesterday in opening round games. We'll see a few more play-in style, early round games, whatever you want to call them, tonight. To me, I think it's well documented that Scotia is potentially the best team in the entire area. They're certainly the most accomplished team in Class A, but I think this is a really deep Class A field. I think that Troy, obviously, they haven't really been healthy all year. They're starting to get healthy now. They can certainly give Scotia a game as they did last year. I think Averill Park is kind of an unknown in Class A coming down from Class AA, and Amsterdam had a great year. I think Scotia's the best team for sure, but I don't think it's going to be just as easy as everyone assumes. What do you think?
No, I agree. I think, you know, when I got the brackets a week ago, I kind of said, okay, here's what I'm looking for from, you know, team-wise, that people that can win it throughout the whole brackets. I think AA, there's like six teams that can really win it. The A's, I think there's two. I think it's Scotia and Troy, but I think that Averill Park and Amsterdam, for sure, those semifinal games will be interesting. Because of the matchups, you know, Averill Park is like you said, they've played bigger schools, you know, the whole year, and now they're going to end up, hopefully, if they keep winning and Troy wins, they'll be playing each other. The Bees, it's like seven teams, I think, that can win it. So it's wide open, and again, it comes down to just who's going to compete that day better.
Yeah, we were texting back and forth yesterday. You really like the depth in Class B as well. We saw no real upsets there except number 4, Catskill, goes down to number 13, Ravenna. What makes Class B so exciting, too? You've got some good teams there as well.
Yeah, just the depth, I think. You know, all the way from you start with Hoosick Falls, who we do work with, and then for me personally, I work with almost, you know, a couple players on all those teams. Chalmont has Zach O'Dell and Aiden Frank. They got another kid, Matt Bird, who's, you know, they won the Colonial. They'll be really good. Cahoes with LaForest. I think they're like a 6 seed. Voorheesville was in the championship last year. I think they might have even won the Bees last year. You know, so it's just from 1 through 7. And then we work with a couple guys on Ravenna too. And I know they were pumped up about their win last night. And that's kind of where you see the, you know, I think Catskill's from the Patroon Conference and Ravenna's in the Colonial, and you start getting where, you know, one conference may be better than the other, so the records aren't really a great indicator of how a team really might be. And I think you're going to see that with the Suburban Council, with Abel Park, some of the A schools who play up the whole year.
Dags, what's going on with you right now? What's going on with Dags basketball? I would assume as we're at the end of the season, you're not doing as much with teams or individuals right now. Correct me if I'm wrong, but what's kind of the next step for you? When the season ends, are you going to be getting right back into it with guys?
Yeah, so our big thing all year round in the off season is obviously like our varsity team training, and then our open groups where we go, we're in Saratoga and Colony now, where players come from all over to train with us. And in the wintertime, it kind of slows down. But what we do is we dive into youth training big. So the youth training is kind of subsiding a little bit as their season ends. We'll get out to all these sectional games. We want to see our biggest thing with all our players, how they compete. And, you know, we don't care if they win every game, lose every game. You know, just go out there and compete and do things the right way. And a lot of our players have done that. So we'll get out and see them. And then March, we start right back up. It'll be, you know, I'm doing the scheduling right now. We've hired a couple of new trainers. We hired Julie McBride, who plays, she's like the 4th all-time leading scorer at Syracuse. Now she plays in Poland. And another coach, Carlin DeMarinis, who coaches with the Sparks. She played at Sage. And Shaper Mercy helps us as well. And obviously Zach Bai is always around, you know, to help us train. So we I'm stocking my trainers because we trained over 1,300 players last year. So we're hoping to increase that number this year.
Guys can find you if they want to learn anything about your program, about Dags basketball, on Twitter, at Dags basketball. Where can they find you online, and what can they find on your website?
Yeah, so dagsbasketball.com. You can watch videos of our trainers playing. You can watch some of our sessions. You can find us at Dags basketball for Twitter and Instagram as well.
Steve D'Agostino helping us break down the Section 2 playoffs. Steve, hopefully we're getting you back on here before sectionals ends here. Certainly exciting time, some good matchups on the horizon. I'll be out at Hudson Valley this weekend. I'm sure you will be as well.
Perfect. I'll see you there anytime, Brady.